Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we continue with prompt engineering, second part of this tutorial where I will speak about the different techniques that you can apply to create prompts and query and get the better, the best of the LLM that you are working on. We will be using today Mistral 7 billion. This is quite recent model published not long ago. They claim that is performing better than other models, also new, like Llama 2 with 13 billions, and in that is definitely beating the models with the same number of the odd parameters with 7 billion and is performing similar or better than other models are bigger, like Wizard or Llama 13 billion. And so they are using a novel technique that is the slide window attention layer, which take care of the previous 4096 hidden states. And well, if you want some additional information, just take a look to the information, to the research paper I posted here as well, and also to the card that is available in Hugging Face, where you can see a description of how to use it, how to build simply prompts that they had to have these marks telling the test when start and finish the instructions, and there is some other context information as well. Every model at the end of the day had their own set of their own templates, if you can say that, and you need to be aware of how to do it in order to get the best of the model and use it at the end of the day correctly. Okay, so we install the libraries we need. We are going to use the model with the 8-bit quantization. So it's one of the techniques in a separate tutorial I will explain you what is this quantization. Is a technique to load the models in smaller GPUs, if you can say that. But well, for now, just keep in mind that we need to use special parameters to load this model. And well, just follow for now. And again, in another tutorial, I'll explain what exactly means this quantization 8 bits that is using this model. For the rest, the model is using the same parameters, conventional parameters you see here. Again, it's a small model, only 15 gigabytes size. The shape tensors files is the sharding, the parts, the chunks of the model. Again, it's not a big model, so you can work in a conventional A100 and it's gonna work perfectly, no problems. You see that we are after loading the model in the GPU, we are using just 8.1 gigabytes. We create a configuration, generate 2048 new tokens, temperature 0.8, and use some randomness. This parameter means essentially that don't allow the model not to choose the most likely next token, and give the chance to less likely tokens to be included on the selection on the new generated tokens, especially when you produce large or long sentences. It's good to have this randomness activated in order to get a more rich and more close to the human language answer. We create the streamer, we create a pipeline as well, with our tokenizer, with our model, generate full text, generate just one sequence, and the pack token and of the sentence token. And well, we start here with the technique. The most simple one is what probably you all of us know, is the zero-shot prompting, in which you simply send a question and you ask for an answer from your model. You probably do plenty of times ChatGPT, but actually it works the same. That only again, you just need to enclose in between each these two tokens the instruction when you are working with the Mistral. And here we just we are trying to classify the model in between these three classes, and it's a sentimental analysis, and essentially, well, the model shouldn't is answering neutral, I suppose. Yeah, well, it's correct. In my opinion, as well, is neutral. No. Fusion fronting is an extension, not zero shot, but it's just giving some examples to the LLM in order to, well, to have a context and to understand how it should answer to the question. Some of these examples can come as well with output formatting, similar to what you probably were doing on ChatGPT or with GPT-4, and essentially you are telling, well, listen, this is a question, this is how, well, you should answer. It's essentially giving some examples, and this way he can replicate the model. The model can replicate what you were giving in the samples. So let's get a try here. Prompting means that it can be one or n samples. The study says some research papers you can find available. I will try to find as well and post it on the notebook. That more than 4 to 6 samples are enough, maximum 6, and more than that is not efficient. You are going to reduce the ability of the model to answer you, and more than six examples in the prompt is not gonna perform better. The LLM is not going to give you a better answer. Chain of through prompting is a variant of few-shot prompting, but here is more oriented a reasoning to drive the model into a chain of thinking similar to what a human should be, no, should do. And then here is just creating an algebra problem, and then on you are in the example you explain the model what is the rationale behind how you create the answer, no? And then on in the second, in the prompt, you are just introducing the same question, and you, well, the expectation is the model should follow the same rational or a similar rational that the model will replicate the rational that you introduce on the example. Here we have an example, and then here we are just giving again as a mathematical very simple problem in where you have a group of numbers, and then you just ask to take the odd numbers, sum them up, and answer if the output is an odd number or not. And then you make an example and you ask the LLM to do the same, no? So for what I observe, this model is working fine in most of the, but in this specific case, in reasoning, is not performing very well. Probably we can improve this, giving more examples or building more rich explanations to the model, or describing more with more steps. But something that you will find as well in many models, that not all the models are performing, how to say, at the same level in all kind of activities that the LLMs can solve. So in this case, well, for what we see, this Mistral with 7 billion, well, it's somehow capturing the rationale behind, but is failing obviously in the answer. So I tried several times introducing more examples. You can play around also with the parameters of temperature, also with the tokens or top P, yeah, with different parameters. But well, from my observations here, well, here is close, but again, here odd numbers are 15, 5, 13, 7, 1. Here is missing one, and also some of the examples where you see the sum up is 20, 40, and the sum up is for then 45. So, yeah, it's getting close, but in this case it's wrong. No, so well, it's just an example. Probably again with a better prompting, more example, you can play around with this and see that you finally get a question. What I want to mention here as well, just keep in mind that it's a 7 billion model. If we compare this with GPT-4, which had 1.13 trillion of the parameters, well, we need to balance. It's a trade-off, no? At the end of the day, how much could cost to train it, even possible, a model like like GPT-4 or a model like Mistral 7B, and the performance. Later we can use some metrics to compare how well it's performing one and the other, no? But the outputs are not bad, in some tasks are really good, and the size of the model is quite small, no? On the tutorial of quantization, we will go into details about that, because this is a key factor at the time that you choose a model to solve the use case of the project that you are working on. Another technique is a zero shot combining with a chain of truth. You can take a look to this paper. I think that we discussed this paper in some of the tutorials before. It's just drive the or instruct the model to do a breakdown of the answer, no? Trying to be consistent in how it's solving the problem. So here we are going to use a simpler zero-shot prompting, and you will see here that it's failing in the answer, no? It's just failing. Is wrong. We had 10 apples, we gave 2 to the neighbor, 2 to the repairman, this means 6, we bought 5 additional, this means 11, and we ate 1, so the answer is 10. No? So it just include exactly the same instruction up to here, and just introduce, as the paper said, let's think step by step. You will see that the model is behaving absolutely different. And then maybe we can try as well on the previous problem. So here you see it's doing a breakdown of the steps. So first is exactly or very similar to what a human will be doing in this kind of problems, no? Okay. And then on now is giving you a correct answer. And again, keep in mind that this model, you can train it even in a cheap hardware, fine tuning as well in a cheap hardware, and it's giving you solving problems that in some cases, for example, GPT 3.5 Turbo will not do correctly most of the cases. Let's do the same on the previous one, in the previous problem. Maybe we can get here this time a better answer. So the group is clear, it's detecting. Okay, you see here 15, yeah, is identifying the group. Yeah, here is failing as well. But the rationale, again, the steps is breaking down the answer in different steps. And, well, essentially, it's not identifying the numbers, the odd numbers, so it's not looking at the with the attention to what we had in the example. Again, probably here we need to introduce more examples to get at the he follows the rationale behind. Well, another technique is self consistency, is another variant as well of the few shot prompting. The only here is, well, again, you break down as well the answers in the examples that you provide to the model. Here, let's check it as well. Is essentially very similar to this example. Also, to this one. Sorry. Yeah, to this one. But here you will see with more examples that as well these problems of reasoning are not are not performing very well on this model. So here, is mistaken. So let's try again. When your sister works hard for your time, this means your sister 3 years old at that time. Now you are 70. Yeah, now it's working. So sometimes, you need to shout two times. But well, at the end, again, is solving correctly the problem, no? Generate knowledge prompting is another technique. All of them, again, they are variants, some of them are experimental. Here what we try to do in the prompt is introduce some knowledge which help the LLM to answer the question. Here we are introducing some general knowledge apart of some model. Here some knowledge about calls, no? And then we are asking the model the call is trying to get a higher point total than others, and well, you will see here how the model is answering. So but you can see here very well that at the end you try to drive the model into give you a different a correct answer, just either introducing additional information or giving examples to the model, no? We can plenty play with these techniques after you get the right answer. So you see here is giving just the same question with just some piece of knowledge that practically the knowledge is answering the question, no? This we'll see now later in the technique in RAC, which is you probably hear about that, essentially try to solve another problem, the hallucination problem, and also the problem of auto-take information at the time that you try. But it's another technique that you can be used as well in prompt engineering. here we had another example of knowledge of the generated knowledge fronting. And you will see here that yeah, it's answering correctly, but again, if you read the knowledge that we are introducing, it's practically answering the question. So it's just interpreting what we get in the model. It's just driving or helping the model in giving you the rises. So that's why the prompt engineering many times is key, how we build the prompts in order to get the best from the model. Prompt chaining is essentially use the prompt to the output of a prompt to generate another prompt, to fine tune another prompt. So here in the example, we are just using a document. First of all, we do a summarization. We just take in this example part of the model. We just say the model to generate some quotes from the 5,000 first characters of the model. Is just to do a small summarization, and then on we use this summary, these quotes, to as a prompt for a next prompt for your next query. And this is very similar how you build the conversational chatbox, and where you are reinforcing the answers of the bot with the questions and the answers that the bot gives you previously, with the history of questions that you make to the. This way also the LLM had the contents and the history and the status of what was happening before. It's a mix of some of these techniques that you are showing here. At the end, as I said before, most of them are variants orientated in some cases to specific problems like reasoning or solving mathematical questions, how you conduct or drive the model into answering correctly to the questions, just giving some tricks. You will see now in another technique how you introducing additional information in the prompt to help the model to answer correctly to the question that you are that you sent to the model. And again, well, practically here is extracting it should be the highlights of the document, but for what I've seen is just exactly extracting practically the content of the document, no? But well, we limit to 5,000, and well, we do the same here, but now with introducing the quotes. Yeah, well, okay. The three of those, which is another variant of few shot here, we provide some examples and how we will solve the problems. Here is just giving some alternatives in the prompt that we build and send to the LLM. We are giving some alternatives and how this can be solved. No, it's just giving a path of how you or the human is solving the problem. No, how the person is breaking down the problem, exploring different alternatives. And this is at the end how we build this or use this technique is exactly like that. We get the model, we solve, okay, we can explore this path, this is getting nowhere, we can explore this other alternative, and finally this we say we show the model how a person is thinking or solving a problem. I put here two examples of how this is implemented in Python. You can take a look there and you will see where there is how they are solving puzzles, or and this is solving another game. You can see how is this done with these techniques and querying an NLM. Retrieved augmented generation, well, essentially again this technique was used to think to solve two problems that well, mainly the problem of hallucination, that many times the problem the model is just like feeling the need to answer whatever is whatever answer, sometimes wrong, is grammatically correct, but when you see the answer is a nonsense. I think I show you an example with ChatGPT, just asking who is the president of UK, and then the model is just going to answer you. Well, it will answer you with a president, but well, it's sometimes this is wrong. Who is the PM of UK? Prime Minister, sorry for that. Yeah. And then he's asking Boris Johnson. Obviously, in January 2024, it's not Boris Johnson, and the problem is that the model is just answering you with the information that he has on his or that information that was used when at the moment of the pre-train the model. And then at the time, GPT 3.5 Turbo was released in 2022, if I'm not wrong, and then at that time obviously was Boris Johnson in power. Today is not him anymore, and then yeah, the model is just answering you, but it's grammatically correct, no? But is this information is up to date? Then it was in this technique was introduced to solve this problem, the problem of outdated information, and what means and the problem of the hallucination, that the model feels like the need to he had to answer you, or he had to answer you and give you an answer, whatever, it doesn't matter if it is correct or not correct. And then there is a very interesting, well, at the end, retrieval augmented generation is just provide with a source of truth or source of information, external source, like a news database, or with some additional information, external source that help the model introduce this information in the model. When the model detect that this the question is not in quotas in the information that it was used for training that model, it just make a query to the external system to retrieve the relevant information to build an answer. This is very easily implemented in LangChain, in the library LangChain, and that you can query different external systems to retrieve the information, like here they say Wikipedia, or even news sources or whatever, no? This is just a matter to provide additional information to build the answers. You will see now that there is other variants as well, how we can do improve RAC, no? And then on here there is this very interesting link about what is hallucinations in LLMs, and then we can make a try here. And then we are just simply asking how many M's there is in the world weather, which is obviously no one, but the LLM is just and sharing with one, no? And then you introduce in the prompt the answer and ask the if the model is, you are sure, no, to the model that the answer that it gives you is correct or not. The model will insist even on the problem, seeing that is trying to give you an answer. It doesn't matter. You see, the answer is even makes sense, no? For somebody who doesn't have the knowledge, I will say, well, the model is answering me correctly, but it's completely wrong. So now it's answering two words, no? And then if you introduce again, you can even mislead more and more the model. This is what means hallucinations. The model itself is just trying to answer. Yeah, and then here is insisting on the error. It's very interesting article. You can play around with ChatGPT, with GPT 3.35 Turbo. It happens as well the same. It's trying to answer you even a wrong answer. It's not a problem of the Mistral, it's a problem of all LLMs. Another technique is similar to RAG, but it's automatic reasoning and tool. It's just introducing in the middle, it's very similar to RAG. It's introducing external information from a tool. Here we had a library of tags with answers, and then you, depending on the question that you send to the LLM, you introduce relevant information from your task library, but essentially very similar to RAG, no? Similar as well, API. API is use an LLM to produce prompts that later on are going to be sent to another LLM and do a kind of evaluation of the output. So it's using an LLM to query another LLM and using a third LLM to evaluate the answers of the model that you are testing. So it's at the end introducing, trying to create prompts with different techniques and evaluating at the same time with another LLM the answers of the model that you want finally to test. Active prompt is essentially the same, but you introduce on the loop the human being, which evaluate or give a score to the different answers that questions and answers that you send to an LLM. Here what we are doing is send to an LLM different prompts with different techniques, one zero shot with code, and then on these are scored by a human telling you, well, this is good, this is not good, or from a range of 0 or 1 to 9 or 1 to 10, and then on we use these scores in the loop to improve and to drive the decision or the answer of the model that we are testing or we're trying to improve. Very similar technique to something that you may also have here in this area, that is the reinforcement learning for human feedback. That is a fine-tuning technique that improve the answers of the models. But we can discuss as well this in another tutorial. Directional stimulus prompting, which essentially is again another few short techniques, but you are giving ticks, some hints that help the model to focus on the answer. No, you, for example, here in the picture, you can say, we want to summarize this text, and you essentially in the prompt, you are telling, okay, here is like pointing out to the relevant words or tokens that you need to use to make the answer, no? And then you see here in the example with a standard prompting, we get roach is a measure very widely used on summarization problems, and then as bigger roach the best, no? And then you see that giving some tips or introducing some tips or some in some tips on the prompt, you get a much more refined answer or summary on what you have in your input text. And the last technique that we will see today is PAL, which essentially is another variant of the diffusion, but they are using a well-known fact that most of these models are really good in understanding program language. Why? Because program language are quite structured. They are, you could say, fixed grammar. There is a very simple grammar and how you build a programming language. And then only you just get an example of how this is implemented in a pseudo language or in a programming language, you help a lot the model in how to answer a question, a mathematical question, a mathematical problem, no? There is other techniques I also enumerate here, you can take a look, but again, most of them are circling around the same topic that is at the end, giving examples or giving tips or giving direction to the model and how the model should answer. And you do this introducing this information in the prompt. It can be just knowledge that you introduce, additional knowledge from a external source, knowledge that you do with some examples, with some transformations like in this last technique in a program language or a pseudo program language, but at the end all of them is giving direction or tips or hints of how the model should build the answer of this of the question that you are sending to the model. And that's it. Another note aside that I want to do, most of these techniques are experimental. They are tested on a lab environment, so I think that many of these examples that you will see on these documents are working well in a laboratory environment, but you need to be careful when you apply them, and then and read carefully the paper where in which environment how they apply it to which specific problem, because as you will understand, then on when you try to apply this to a problem in a real life problem, most of them need to be, how to say, fine-tuned as well, and it's difficult to understand how they had to be applied, and most difficult is how to fine-tune it for your specific problem when they are even not prepared for that. So that if you plan to do use some of these new techniques that are most of them are experimental, are still only in research papers, you need to be conscious, no, to how to use them and where is possible to be used them. To my experience, most of the what is working today in productive environments are few shot prompting and chain of truth. Those two techniques are widely used, and for example, LAN chain or LAMA chain are introducing these as methods or part of the libraries and are widely used and tested that are working well. If you remember at the beginning of the tutorial, when we introduce just simply the sentence, let's think step by step, that is widely used and is working, performing very well in most of the LLMs. And that's all for now. If you like the tutorial, please give me a like, and if you didn't subscribe, it's now time to do it. Thank you.